Thank you for being here for this very important conversation tonight and to learn together. It's an honor tonight to introduce tonight's special guest. I look forward to what he shares with us. And then afterwards, we will have a conversation with question and answer so that we can think about how what he shares with us might impact our campus and the communities beyond. And I'll say, Ken has been with us since last night, meeting with different groups, and my senior leadership team and other campus leaders spent the morning with him, and it's already been a tremendous learning experience. Kenneth S. Stern is an award-winning author and attorney, director of Bard College's Center for the Study of Hate, part of the Human Rights Program at Bard. The center that Mr. Stern leads does amazing work. I know that they note that they just released a report documenting the economic costs of violence stemming from hate crimes, over $3.4 billion annually. This approach, harnessing knowledge from the academy and employing it to help all of us think more clearly about hatred and what to do about it, as he puts it in the foreword to the report, exemplifies the analytic, grounded, investigative mindset that Kenneth Stern brings to the work regarding anti-Semitism, an approach that equips us as individuals and as a society to actually do something to address what can seem like an intractable social problem. Prior to Bard, Ken was the executive director of the Justice and Karen Rosenberg Foundation, which combats anti-Semitism and anti-Israel activity on campuses. And before that, he directed the Division on Anti-Semitism and Extremism at the American Jewish Community, the AJC, where he worked for 25 years. His op-eds and book reviews have appeared in the Times and the Post. He's appeared on television. He's appeared on NPR's Fresh Air, All Things Considered. He's argued before the U.S. Supreme Court, testified before Congress, and was an invited presenter at the White House Conference on Hate Crimes, and he served as a member of the U.S. delegation to the Stockholm Forum on Combating Intolerance, all of which is to say he is ready for your tough questions. His report on the militia movement, released 10 days before the Oklahoma City bombing, predicted attacks on the government, and the covering memo to the report said that such attacks might occur on April 19, 1995, the anniversary of the deaths of members of the Branch Davidian sect. His report was called Prescient, and the resulting book, A Force Upon the Plain, was nominated for the National Book Award. Ken was the lead drafter of the International Working Definition of Anti-Semitism and also an integral part of the defense team in the historic London Holocaust denial case of David Irving versus Deborah Lipstadt, a former colleague of mine. And he was also defense counsel for Dennis Banks, co-founder of the American Indian Movement. His latest book, The Conflict Over the Conflict, The Israel-Palestine Campus Debate, published in 2020, draws from hate studies to explain how our thinking changes when our identity is tethered to an issue of perceived justice or injustice. His talk tonight is Anti-Semitism and Binary Thinking, Campus Culture, and the Future of Democracy. Please join me in welcoming Ken Stern to Amherst College.
Thank you very much for that kind introduction, and I want to thank all of you for the gracious welcoming that I've had, meeting with students and meeting with staff and meeting with faculty. I've learned more from you folks in the last couple of days than I think you learned from me, so it's wonderful to be here and spend some time further exploring these ideas with you, because as I said, I've learned so much already. So, you know, they say anti-Semitism is on the rise, and including figures that we've seen this last week from the Anti-Defamation League, and it sure can feel that way. But I want to spend some time tonight thinking about what do we mean by rising, and more generally, what is anti-Semitism, and how should we be thinking about it? And I believe that anti-Semitism is best understood as two things at its core. It's conspiracy theory, saying that Jews conspire to harm non-Jews. And the second component is that harm that Jews do, that conspiring that Jews do, explains what goes wrong in the world. And it's been a conspiracy theory for a long time. Jews responsible for the death of Jesus, and Jews responsible for the Black Plague. Jews were seen as poisoning wells, and that explained why people were dying. Christian children would disappear, particularly around Easter time, and the allegation was Jews were stealing Christian children, draining their blood to make matzah, called the blood libel. There were times where simultaneously communism and capitalism as problems for society were explained as the evil machinations of the Jew. And the one of the greatest promoters of it was a book called The Protocols of the Elders of Zion. I'm just curious, how many people here know about The Protocols of the Elders of Zion? Okay, a couple of younger people, but mostly the older folks. It was a forgery that was the fuel for many of the pogroms in 100 years ago in Europe, and it was a forgery that suggested that Jews were secretly behind the scenes in cemeteries and other places plotting for control of the world, plotting controlling the government, plotting controlling the media. It was explaining things through that lens of Jewish conspiracy, what goes wrong in the world. And we tend to think of conspiracy theories as sort of, you know, Nazi things, but the protocols in the United States was being promoted on a large scale by no one other than Henry Ford, the auto magnate. And he not only reprinted and popularized it, he had his own version called the International Jew. So it was like a huge figure promoting the idea of Jewish conspiracy. But it's not only on the far right, and it's not only among, you know, white supremacists. The Nation of Islam and Louis Farrakhan promoted the protocols and also has its own version of a book called The Secret Relationship Between Blacks and Jews that explains slavery and other problems for the black community through the lens of Jewish conspiracy. And, you know, not to be outdone, last couple of years, Marjorie Taylor Greene retweeted about, well, California forest fires, you know, could it be Jewish space lasers? You know, it's the explanation for what goes wrong in the world. So think about Charlottesville and the Unite the Right rally. And here we were, a bunch of white supremacists getting together to preserve and protect the Robert E. Lee statue. And they start chanting, Jews will not replace us. Jews will not replace. How did Jews get into this thing with Robert E. Lee? Well, you know, when looking at bigotry, it's really useful to, as opposed to just condemning it, do a thought experiment and think about how you would look at the world if you were in their shoes. You're a white supremacist, right? And you see yourself being threatened by what you perceive as inferior people. Brown and black people are going to be the numerical majority, you know, in a few decades in the United States. And you see you're losing to people that are inferior. How could that possibly be that you lose to somebody inferior? There has to be somebody tipping the scales. That would be the Jews. Jews will not replace us. Now, although anti-Semitism is conspiracy theory about Jews, it's a mistake to think about it only as related to what people are saying about Jews. And for a recent example of that, just think of the Tree of Life shooting that killed 11 Jews in Pittsburgh a couple of years ago. Robert Bowers, the person who is the mass murderer, what were the things that were upsetting him as he was deciding to do this? It was the vitriol against, quote, invaders from the southern border that President Trump and others were echoing. We're being invaded. We have to do something. He decided he was going to do something. And it so happened that the Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society, HIAS, had a meeting at the Tree of Life Synagogue. So he went that day and decided, okay, I'm going to do something about these invaders, and figured that's what he's going to do. Clearly anti-Semitic. Look at the Walmart shooting a couple of months later in El Paso against Mexican-Americans and Mexicans. Nobody would classify that as an act of anti-Semitism. But if you look at the ideology and the drivers of the two shooters, they were almost identical. They just happened to choose a different target. One decided it's going to deal with the invaders directly. One saw Jews as responsible. But their ideology was nearly identical. And, you know, so I'm a firm believer that to think about anti-Semitism, we have to have a wide lens about what's driving things like that, as opposed to just thinking only what happens about Jews. So what's the relationship between anti-Semitism and hate more broadly? And the Jewish community is concerned, and there have been times, and I can give you examples in Q&A if you want, where something anti-Semitic happens and people trying to dismiss it and make it homogenized disappear behind a generalized hatred and racism. And that's a problem, and we could talk about that. But the flip side, I think, is the more important. That, you know, it's not as if Jews were the only group experiencing hatred. Anti-Semitism is not floating alone among there as a subset of the human capacity to hate. And I think it's helpful to think about it through a hate studies lens. And I'm not going to go into great detail about hate studies, but let me just give you a definition of what it is so you can understand what I'm referring to. It's defined as inquiries into the human capacity to define and then demonize or dehumanize an other. So define and then demonize or dehumanize another, and the processes which inform and give expression to or can curtail, control, or combat that capacity. So notice there are two different types of hatred that we look at in terms of hate studies. One is the one we normally think about, the visceral, I hate you, angry, fearful hatred. And the other is the sort of more normative that demonize and dehumanize. And you can think about slavery that way. This is just the way the world works. Don't get your blood boiling about it. You know, if you're a slave owner, this is just the way things are organized. But if you think about how hatred has worked throughout history, the sad fact is no matter where, no matter when, no matter what political system, no matter what economic system, no matter what major religion, no matter any other variable you choose to slice and dice, we've always had the capacity to divide into us and them. And then frequently that division of us and them leading to demonization, dehumanization. And there's a lot in the academy that looks at these issues and has a lot to say about them, but they're siloed for the most part. We look at psychology and we look at the individual. We look at social psychology and we look at the group. We look at political science and we look at how this reflects in power. And there are other fields like brain science and philosophy that also look at how other emotions are associated with, like, fear and anger and disgust and so forth. But hate studies is a desire to pull together all these disparate aspects of our knowledge to provide testable answers to how we look at hatred. You know, much like medicine is a combination of subfields, biology, chemistry, and physics, or architecture is a combination of art and physics and math, because one case we need to deal with the fact that humans get sick, and others that humans need structure. So this is a way to try to pull together that knowledge to help us think about hatred and tonight anti-Semitism more holistically. So I'm a firm believer that perceiving who in us and who is them is a core part of the human condition, something our brains do rather naturally. And we forget sometimes in discussing these issues that we're animals with our brains developed millennia ago, when knowing who is us and who is them was critically important, when there's, you know, the them over the hill. And there's a lot of brain science and evolutionary psychology and others to support this. I mean, just to quote Jim Waller, who wrote about it, evolutionary psychology, just think of it, if it's, you know, snakes and spiders and how you react to them in automobiles. If you think about it, we have much more of a visceral reaction to snakes and spiders than we do to automobiles, which are we more likely to be harmed by? But our brains were formed in a lot of our old brains are driving a lot of how we think and how we feel, and our brains are fashioned to make quick decisions about who's us and who's them, who's the in-group and who's the out-group. But in-groups and out-groups aren't all the same, and some are more central to our lives, you know, perhaps our religion or our ethnicity, and some less so, sort of like which sports teams we root for. But evidence shows that when our identity, our type of, is one of great importance to us and perceived under threat, certain things happen. We strive for certainty. We believe that we are right and they are wrong or worse. And hatred of others, anti-Semitism included, is frequently expressed as noble protection of self, of our group, from a threat from another group. And hate, anti-Semitism included, is also, in my view, a human response to the world in which we live every day. We filter our lives through an endless evaluation of what and who is us and who is them. We seek simpler formulas to avoid the angst of perpetual questioning or uncertainty. We downplay or ignore when our side is behaving badly, and we emphasize or exaggerate when the other side does. Facts and arguments that I might be wrong when we're in these bubbles are not merely dismissed, but they're sometimes redefined as part of a conspiracy and twisted like pretzels to prove that I'm right. And conspiratorial thinking, we were talking about that today in the staff meeting, you know, it's easy. I mean, we tend to think that conspiracy thinking is nutsy. And it is, but it's so easy to construct, to take one thing out of context. Let me give you an example. You know, I've talked about Holocaust denial, which is a type of anti-Semitism. It's really not about the Holocaust. It's about Jews manipulating and making up the history of the Holocaust for a bunch of nefarious purposes, the creation of Israel, the reparations and so forth. That's how the Holocaust deniers spin it. And what they do is they try to make it sound absolutely rational, how this Jewish conspiracy works. So they'll say things like the Anne Frank diary, which you all know. The Anne Frank diary is a fraud. Seminal piece of Holocaust literature. Why do they say it's a fraud? There's writing in ballpoint pen in the manuscript. And that's true. There is writing in ballpoint pen. They'll also say that the ballpoint pen, it was not available certainly, generally until after World War II, and certainly not somebody hiding in Amsterdam. So both those things are true. The pen was a post-war invention, and there was writing in the manuscript. So what's wrong with this picture? I can see you thinking that, no, there's something wrong. It's very, it's easy answer. Her father, Otto Frank, was making emendations in a copy with ballpoint pen after the war. I mean, clearly, this was tons of evidence that this was written as we know it is. But it's easy to take one thing out of context to make it seem like, oh, maybe somebody's hiding something from me. Maybe something happened differently. And this, hate and conspiratorial thinking isn't just among these, folks that believe in QAnon and other conspiracy theories. It's not just on the fringe that I see conspiratorial thinking and hatred. It's also in the mainstream, too, and in politics. The fact is about hate in politics is that, the us versus them works in politics, or politicians wouldn't use it. And, we were talking at dinner tonight, Trump has made this into an art form with Mexicans as rapists and assertions that all Muslims must register and that immigrants are invaders and the Kung Flu and Jew with special business skills and Israel being your country. But, there's now selling the idea that there are conspiracies to promote hatred of him and his supporters, the fake media. And working with the Democrats to steal elections, and George Soros, a Jew, prominent among the forces behind the alleged conspiracy, similar to how the idea decades ago of a Rich Rothschild was used to promote anti-Semitism and ideas of Jewish conspiracy. But we also see hate in other ways in politics today, and us in vilification, in debates about abortion, and immigration, and religion in the public spheres, and over what's being taught in schools, and how we treat people with different gender and sexual identities. And politicians know they'll get our blood boiling when our guts tell us that we are being treated unfairly and threatened by them. When we buy into a system of thought that makes us feel good because we're fighting for our clearly correct and virtuous in-group against an external threat, our thinking becomes increasingly binary and frequently passionate. And you're mentioning about the militia movement. One guy I worked with in Montana, the head of the Montana Human Rights Network in the 90s, had a beautiful metaphor about the militias that I'll share with you. He described the militia groups as a funnel moving through space. And what he meant by that was that at the wide end of the funnel, there were people being sucked in by mainstream issues. In that case, it was gun control and use of federal land and so forth. And he posited that once you got into this system, the self-reinforcing system, you got further and further exposed to conspiratorial thinking. And once you got further into the funnel, you got exposed to the anti-Semitic conspiracy theories. And once you got to the small end, people like the Oklahoma City bomber, Timothy McVeigh, popped out. And what was beautiful about that metaphor to me is it suggested that this hatred and conspiratorial thinking works as a system, and the more people you push into the big end of the funnel, the more they're going to come out of the small end. And we tend to focus on the people, you know, that come out of the small end, but I'm more concerned about the drivers into the large end. And what I see today is that we have more and larger funnels than we maybe had, you know, 25, 30 years ago. So when we're thinking about anti-Semitism, it's important to think about the funnel. And not just the, you know, the limit our thinking to what anti-Semitism, what people are saying, you know, about Jews. You know, haters, as I've suggested, seek to simplify the world and, you know, make themselves virtuous and everything is clear and right and wrong and so forth. But the fact is that we all have human brains. And whereas they have comfort from the simple collective way, in certain way they look at the world, so do those of us who fight bigotry and hatred too. We also get into our tribal tents, and you know, we tend to have the same type of thinking problems that I think people that also promote hate do. So not only do we simplify, we ignore the denominator. When something happens, we, instead of saying how frequent is it, how really should we be concerned, we make it ubiquitous. And we usually make decisions based on what we feel and presume, sometimes out of anger, sometimes for other reasons. But rather than asking, is what I know complete? What else don't I know? We tend to be in our own buckets, and what economist Daniel Kahneman calls what you see is all there is, not seeking incomplete information, which includes why others may have a different point of view, like on Israel-Palestine. We crave symbols. You know, symbols are very important in this sphere. I mean, we see it on the hateful side, you know, with swastikas and so forth. But I also worry about the craving of symbols as having a harmful effect on the efforts against anti-Semitism. And I promised last night to the students I would talk a little bit about why I see this in relating to what's called the IRA definition of anti-Semitism. So I'm going to spend a couple of minutes on that here, you know, and we can talk more in question and answer too. But I see the wars that we have in the Jewish community over this as a problem. Let me explain how this came about. After the collapse of the peace process in 2000 and the beginning of the Second Intifada, there was a marked and continued uptick in attacks on Jews in Europe, particularly Western Europe. And in 2004, there was a group called the European Monitoring Center on Racism and Xenophobia that was tasked to do reports on such thing. And they issued a report, and generally it was good. It found that the attacks on Jews were being committed by white supremacists, the usual suspects, but there were also young Arabs and Muslims who were attacking Jews too. And they said, you know, we have a challenge because we have all these different countries in Europe that are supposed to provide data, but hardly any definitions, you know, maybe a couple of places are not the same, most places don't. We don't know what to ask our bean counters, in effect, to count. And they said, we're going to have a temporary definition, and we're going to define anti-Semitism as a series of stereotypes about Jews, which, you know, had some methodological problems, but leave that aside. I found that it was a political move to have that temporary definition, because then they said, what do we do if a Jew on the streets of Paris or London is attacked as a stand-in for an Israeli? And they said, well, if the person has these stereotypes about Jews, applies them to Israelis, then reapplies them to the Jew in front of them, that's anti-Semitism. But if they're upset at something Israel does and attacks the Jew in front of them, that's lamentable but shouldn't be counted. And I'm thinking, that's nuts. I mean, I grew up, you know, in the 50s and 60s, Can you imagine if somebody was stringing a black person up from a tree in the South and somebody said, well, you know, the person who did that, we should count it as racist because the person thought black people were shiftless and lazy. But if they were upset at a Martin Luther King speech or the passage of civil rights legislation and the poor person was attacked, that's not racism. So in one of those coincidences that worked out well, the head of the EUMC was coming to the American Jewish Committee annual meeting, and about a few weeks beforehand, Israel assassinated a Hamas leader and somebody in retaliation firebombed a Jewish day school in Montreal. Nobody was hurt, thank God. Not anti-Semitism, according to the way that they were calibrating this. So I took the opportunity to challenge them, put together a team. I was the lead drafter of a definition that's primary purpose was to give the bean counters something to count and to do a couple of things. I mean, to take the temperature, set up a model across borders and across time, but also to stop the confusion over what was an anti-Semitic hate crime or not. It was following the U.S. Model of the case of Wisconsin v. Mitchell, saying that when you attack somebody, when you select them based on who they are, it doesn't matter if you hate them or not. So if you attack a Jewish person because they're Jewish, doesn't matter if you think that, you know, I have a positive stereotype, all Jews are rich, therefore I'm going to kidnap one and ransom him, which happened, and there were debates about whether that was anti-Semitic or not. Now, that should be counted as anti-Semitism. You're kidnapping a Jew because they're Jewish. Same as in retaliation for Israel. And in the definition, the bean counter is something to measure over time and across borders. There were a bunch of examples that included ones about Israel. And the reason they were there was because we saw a correlation between the type of rhetoric that was targeted in those examples and the attacks on Jews. Not to say that there was a causation, but you could look at the charts of the attacks on Jews and the type of rhetoric, and they were almost overlapping. So again, it was not to label anyone an anti-Semite, but to really take a temperature and to give us data for that. But what happened in this binary is that some people on the pro-Israel Jewish side decided this was too good a tool to not weaponize. So what happened? Starting in 2010, the Department of Education had what's called a Dear Colleague Letter. There's something called Title VI. That protects an educational environment against severe harassment and intimidation so that it denies somebody the ability to have an equal education. And the potential remedy for a Title VI violation is it threatens funding. And I thought that was a great thing. There were Jewish high school students outside of Binghamton. I was the complainant for them. They were having pennies thrown at them, swastikas put on their backpacks. It was a kick of Jew Day. School did hardly anything, and we used that power. I was in favor of it. But groups like the Zionist Organization of America decided, let's wed the definition with this new power. So they started bringing Title VI cases, and they were complaining in part about things that were reasonable to complain about, spitting and so forth. But the complaints were replete with mention of speech that they saw as violative of the definition in their view. Things like texts assigned in class, or speakers brought to campus, or programs about the occupation, or films. So all things that were, you know, proper for an academic community, ideas being looked at. You might disagree with them, but they say, no, that was a Title VI violation or should be part of consideration of it. All those cases lost, and then what did they say? Well, they said at least it had a positive impact. It stopped a lot of the pro-Palestinian organizing, and it put administrators on notice that if they don't chill or suppress this type of speech, they're going to have to, you know, look at the potential of a Title VI complaint and a lawsuit. Then they tried to get the University of California to adopt the definition. It didn't. Now it's called the IHRA definition because the EUMC no longer exists and the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance adopted the definition in 2016, and they try to push Congress to adopt it and say, when you're looking at a case of anti-Semitism on a campus, you have to consider this definition of anti-Semitism in evaluating your cases. And the reason for it is very simple. Jared Kushner wrote an op-ed in the New York Times explaining it, and he said, our administration's position is anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism, pure and simple. Well, people mean various different things by Zionism, but and we could talk about that in question and answer, but it's basically the Jewish people's right to self-determination, and of course, it's exercised in Jews' historic home, the land of Israel. But some anti-Zionism is anti-Semitic, especially with Jewish conspiracy and tropes. But I'm a Zionist, and I can imagine if I were a Palestinian, I might have a different view about it. Some may hate Jews, and Hamas's original charter even references the protocols. But most Palestinians I know who are anti-Zionists are not because they hate Jews or believe that Jews are the only group that don't have a right to national rights or that they believe in Jewish conspiracy, but they see Zionism as a disaster for them. Second point about the binary inside the Jewish community as we're debating Zionism and Israel, it's a question of whether who's inside the tent and who's outside the tent. In the Jewish community, the Satmars are ultra-Orthodox. They're anti-Zionist for a theological reason. They don't believe the state should exist until the Messiah comes. But there are young Jews on some campuses of groups like If Not Now that are agnostic about Zionism or anti-Zionist. And for some of them, it's religiously based too. It's a belief that how can I justify the existence of Israel with what Judaism teaches me about repairing the world or how to treat this stranger. And I don't know how those things, that internal battle can be decided. I just know sure as heck I don't want state legislatures and Congress deciding that for us. I don't think that's appropriate. I think it has church-state implications. I don't think it's bad policy. So the implications on campus, it not only threatens more programs and speakers, but also what a professor can teach. That's why the Association for Jewish Studies was testified with me against it in Congress, because they are afraid that there are going to be these outside groups hunting people using these texts and bringing these speakers. And you know, to me, that's a detriment of academic freedom and harms Jewish scholarship. Make no mistake, I'm deeply concerned about the binary of some on the pro-Palestinian side, folk trying to censor pro-Israel ones on campus, or instances of heckler's vetoes, or academic boycotts, which I think are totally anathema to the lifeblood of a campus. But on the pro-Israel side in this binary, I also see using instruments of state, and that's dangerous. And to give you an example, in the UK, which did adopt the definition, there was an Israel Apartheid Week event at a campus that was scheduled, and the definition was used as a way to say this can't happen. It was shut down. And the Simon Wiesenthal Center, a United States-based group, said not only was that right to shut it down using the definition, but that every university everywhere should stop that. Well, I'm no great fan of Israel Apartheid Week, but you don't use instruments of state to stop it. I think that people are looking in the Jewish community for IRA as a silver bullet because it comforts them. It makes them think that this is the answer. We have it right here. We use law that way. And it's not only counterproductive, it's, ridiculous. It claims that you can't understand anti-Semitism without this sort of sorting tool. I worked at AJC for 25 years before him. We understood anti-Semitism. Nobody said you had to run Kanye's DEFCON 3 statement through the definition to understand it was anti-Semitic. But its main use has been as a blunt instrument against pro-Palestinian speech. And part of this is because it's so difficult and contentious. In my book, I had, because I had to set out what the two narratives were, the Jewish narrative and the Palestinian narrative, writ large against, not everybody's going to agree with them, but I set them out in broad brushes. And I had somebody that looked at the manuscript and said, it's really important which one you decide to put first. And I thought that was right. I ended up putting the Jewish one first, but I ended up putting, the Jewish one with the connection to the land and the history of the Bible and where the, temples fit, the story of the Seder, all the next week, all the connections to the land that's important to Judaism, let alone events in the 20th century. But I put a long footnote at the end, and I said, if this is how you see the issues, imagine if I had started with the Palestinian narrative. and started bringing in Jews as a secondary character that were mostly in opposition to our expressing our national rights and our self-identity. How would you feel if you were secondary characters in that story? And I said, you have to recognize and have the intellectual imagination to recognize that's how many Palestinians see that, and it has nothing to do with hating Jews. But this is a conflict, and I see some on the pro-Palestinian side also feeding into that binary, saying there is no conflict. There's just justice and injustice, and you know that's the flip side of what I'm seeing on the pro-Israel side. But I'm worried on the pro-Israel side that IRA has become just like a symbol, like a flag, something binding and comforting, and when opposing it, seen in terms of desecration. You know, as a general rule on hatred, imagine if we had a definition of racism that was being used in the same way to propose by legislation, the idea that we'd say, okay, here are some examples of racism to take temperature, opposition to affirmative action, opposition to Black Lives Matters, opposition to removal of Confederate statues. How would you feel if that was enshrined in legislative text saying that's how we think about it? So another concern is instead of nitpicking over what's in or out, I'm concerned about the threats to our democracy that some of this fight is reflecting. And democracy is more than elections and representative government. It's a system of belief stressing the rule of law, importance of rights, especially not those in the majority, fundamental individual rights, speech and religion and press and checks and balances. But at its best, democracy is a belief that we each have an equal stake in and an equal right to be viewed as equal parts of the whole. And there will always be tensions. But the strengths of democracy, and I could answer more in the Q&A, I believe is related to our ability to oppose bigotry and hatred. And we see threats to that today, not just from the right, but also from the left. I'm worried about some of the battles around wokeness today. On one hand, there's a lot of valuable thinking about power and privilege and race. But some want to filter everything through that lens. And it's a binary, like Marxists used to look at, or still do, at bourgeois and proletariat, and economics and class conflict is a part of the puzzle, but it's not all there is. And you know, some of this debate has implications for Jews on campus. First, in some instances, things get reduced to the simple binary of whether a proponent of an idea is white or not. And again, people bring different experiences to their to the field is fine, but to sort out ideas based on skin color is a binary, in my view, wrong. Second, Jews and whiteness isn't a binary. Jews are a people, not just a religion, but a people of different skin color, and although most American Jews are white. But as I said, white supremacists see Jews as anti-white, while some on the left will paint Jews as super white. So if the simple binary is that people who aren't of color can't experience racism or hate, then when Jews face it, they're doubly hurt by hatred and by the dismissal of those who should empathize. And when the dismissal is accompanied by classic anti-Semitic stereotypes about Jews conspiring to control things, that's even worse. Another point. Being certain you're right and wanting to impose your views on another through law, as some in the pro-Israel Jewish community does erode democracy and our progress against hate, because progress around hate, anti-Semitism included, requires protection of democratic norms, and today the trend is the opposite. The left and the right too often want to outlaw speech they don't like, and I'm a firm believer if you give government the ability to suppress speech, it's the speech the government doesn't like, not the speech that you and I don't like. The civil rights movement was a great testament to that. So the free speech fights were fights for human rights and civil rights. The sit-ins at lunch counters were not just an act, but expression of an idea. But it's troubling that some of those who firmly believe anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism, full stop, and believe that the definition should be used and that's what it required, want to use the instrument of state to suppress those ideas. It's harming free speech in the fight against anti-Semitism. I'm not saying ignore speech, but there are other ways to address it by counter-speeching and organizing. But suppressing or chilling like the use of a code like this is not appropriate. And that was the intent of it. It was very clear in the legislative history. The promoters at the Congress were saying, there was a professor removed from his position for an anti-gay blog post or perceived that. Film American Sniper was not being able to be shown on a campus because it was perceived as anti-Muslim. It said, stop us from hearing those things too. Protect us too. And I find that wrong, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. I see some in the pro-Israel group empowering those against democracy because of the binary over Israel. The Zionist Organization of America feted Steve Bannon, who is one of the leading figures behind the alt-right because he's a friend of Israel. And just look at what's happening now in Florida with DeSantis. It was an article in the Forward the other day that, because he's pushing a bill that would threaten funding if there was teaching about critical race theory and gender and so forth. And somebody said, well, look about how this will affect teaching about the Holocaust. You know, an unintended consequence. And that's absolutely right. I co-teach a class this semester with colleagues in the UK, South Africa, and Vienna on colonialism, anti-Semitism, the Holocaust, and gender. And the person who's the Holocaust gender scholar study in Vienna, which is the school that Orban kicked out of Hungary a few years ago and reconstituted in Vienna, is that scholar. I find it highly troubling and ironic that if this law actually passes, what she teaches in Vienna could not be taught in Miami. But we're pushing legislation that's not all that different on IRA. Fighting hatred, in my view, requires a consistent principle. But in binary thinking, what our side does is justified, and we don't look at the consequences. I think it's important as a general principle, if you demand free speech for yourself, as the people on the pro-Israel side do, and I certainly do, you have to speak up for those whose ideas you find deplorable. Not ignore them, not refuse to contest it, but just be against suppressing them. Another point. Some things feel sometimes like anti-Semitism, but not, may not actually be. In rural areas of the U.S., for example, that are presumptively white and Christian, Jews can feel that they don't fully belong. There could be a football game on a Jewish holiday or pressure to sing Christmas carols. And it's the same type of exclusion that Hindus and Muslims and Sikhs would feel. But that all adds to the perception of not feeling, fully belonging. And on the campus, sometimes that happens about knowing holidays of different religions, and that should be an easy thing for people to know, without the students afflicted having to bring it up. But it feels at times for Jewish students that over the campus debates about Israel, those who are pro-Israel feel that they don't fully belong in the politics over Israel. There have been, again, not to make it ubiquitous, it's just been a few incidents, but there have been troubling ones over the last year. In Vermont and New Paltz, there were instances where there were sexual survivors groups, and they said, we're not allowing any Zionists, in one case an Israeli student, to be part of that. You're not welcome here. You can argue that when they decide to do that, they're no longer just a sexual survivor group, they're a pro-Palestinian group. But then think about, what happened at Berkeley Law School. At the beginning of this academic year, the Students for Justice in Palestine chapter in the law school decided to not only have a position that they weren't going to have any Zionist speakers, they asked the 100 other student groups, and I think 9 signed on to, we're not going to have any Zionist speakers. And I wrote about that because it was a difficult issue. I don't know that you want to impose as a university what the politics of a student group could be. You wouldn't want a young Republican club to have to take a Bernie supporter or vice versa. Groups can ask for solidarity. But having the right to exclude doesn't make it right. And to me, it reflected something very similar to McCarthyism, that people felt so certain in their binaries. The communism was evil, therefore we can't have communists in this group, the chess club, whatever. We can't have Zionists in that too. So I found that deeply troubling. Even though they had a right to do that, but what I think, and I said this, to some students there, if you go down that path, at least have the humanity to recognize what this does to your fellow students. That most of the Jewish students have a strong pro-Israel identity, a Zionist identity, and to them it feels the same as if they're being cut from the football team for not playing on Yom Kippur. And think about the fact that if you're really concerned about climate change, does it really help you in that battle to exclude people who have a different position than you on Israel? You know, to me, it's sacrificing what's effective if you think climate change is the most important issue for feeling comfort and purity. But if you're going to do that, and you have the right to do that, and I'll support you publicly that you have the right to do that, at least wrestle with the effect it has on your classmates. A couple other final things to consider as we're thinking about anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism isn't just the number of hate crimes or incidents. The numbers aren't clear, data's not complete, although anti-Semitic ones have historically been the major ones under the religion category. But to think about it, you know, I suggest that we don't look at them in isolation. There's questions about what's an incident, you know, on social media, what you see is sometimes awful, it's lamentable, but you see it against other groups too, we're not clear on precise the data is. Tells us something, but it doesn't tell us everything. Other things to consider when we think about anti-Semitism is rising, let alone a tidal wave, as some are saying. Attitudes are generally much better now than years ago. There's one ADL survey that suggests the opposite, but it's, you know, a recent one, but the protocol for collecting the data has changed, so I'm not sure. And if you look historically, my grandparents had much more trouble with anti-Semitism. They faced restrictive covenants and loss of business opportunities and restrictions on where they might stay and quotas in universities. And my parents had less, although they had some, and I've had even less, and my kids even less. And one of the data points when we look at anti-Semitism is something we don't usually think about, intermarriage. On some level, Jews are being loved to death, whereas they wouldn't have been, you know. And here's another point. George Santos, I don't know, you know, look, think about, you know, the lying congressman from Long Island. He, among the lies he told when he was trying to be elected, said, I'm Jewish. And he wasn't. Could you imagine if he had tried to get elected saying, by the way, I'm Muslim? You know, so those are things to put into consideration, too. You know, and the other data points, too, on the other side, it's undeniable since the attack on the Jewish community in 1999 and since the Second Intifada and the Tree of Life in Colleyville where there's need for more security. And there are, you know, other things that it's undeniable, as the ADL stats show, that identifiable Jews like Orthodox ones in New York and New Jersey are more at risk, absolutely. But it's all to say that Jews perceive a rise, but not a single way to gauge it. I've been involved in these issues for decades, and other than the, you know, 2000 when Lieberman was running, and intermarriage was really the front burner issue, the Jewish community has always said it's rising. So again, a single data point is a mistake without looking at the big picture. So there are many data points, but when we limit our thinking to what people are saying about Jews or Israel, we're blind to the most important data point, in my view, which is pushed by leaders to define one segment of society as both preeminent and under attack, while vilifying the them as somehow noble, even essential, not as hate, but as self-protection. Sam Friedman has a book coming out next year about Hubert Humphrey. I presume most of the young people in this group don't know who Hubert Humphrey was. Vice President under Lyndon Johnson, Democratic candidate in 68, a liberal mayor of Minneapolis. And Sam's book is on Humphrey and the Democratic Party in the convention in 1948. When he was doing his research, he ran across things about Gerald L.K. Smith, who I presume most of the people here don't know either, but he was a big-time anti-Semite. That was a contemporary of Humphrey's, and very similar in class and background and so forth, but entirely different in their politics. And he found in doing his research something that was attributed to Walter Winchell that tags Smith with promoting something called hatriotism. Hatriotism, a blending, a combination of hate and patriotism. And Friedman wrote a piece saying, well, this is what Trump is doing. And I think that that's right. So while there are good signs some today, like the reaction to Kanye, and, you know, in Chappelle's words, he, you know, went overnight from a billionaire to a millionaire, you know, the Emhoff meeting at the White House, but I'm worried about elected officials pushing conspiracy theories, ignoring Trump whining and dining Holocaust deniers, or minimizing the reaction to it, let alone pushing hatredism themselves. So how do we combat anti-Semitism effectively today? There's no silver bullet or single strategy. And this is, again, where I think the push for pushing IRA leads us astray to easy and wrong answers to a problem. So first, strengthen democratic norms and structures. When any group among us is threatened by instruments of state or ideas are being wrong or banned, because it's seen as important to define them as a danger to us, work to oppose such forces. Remember that when Trump and others are saying about immigrant invaders, not Jews, was the backdrop of the Tree of Life. And as vilification of them goes up, so does conspiratorial thinking. Again, the funnel. Anti-Semitism to understand the world becomes more attractive. And finally, you know, to take the opportunity to some words to students. So on campus, what's your job? I can tell you what it's not. It's not to solve the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. I can guarantee that none of you will, maybe when, you know, 20 years from now, you'll be the person that figures it out. Not today. Your job is to explore ideas, to develop the habit of critically re-examining your own thinking. The brightest people I've met in decades of doing this work are people that readily acknowledge that they might be wrong. That doesn't mean you don't believe what you believe, just open to the possibility of recalibrating. Reject anything that seems like groupthink or simplistic formulas. If you feel the comfort of reducing complicated issues to binaries, alarm bells should go off. Experiment. Think. Be willing to be wrong. Wonder why your classmates may have a different point of view. Intellectual curiosity is essential to your work. When I was a criminal defense lawyer for many years, I think it would have been malpractice if I didn't spend some time thinking, okay, if I were the prosecutor, how would I approach this case? You have to have that capacity. Secondly, care about your classmates and others on campus. Disagree, yes, but don't demonize or exclude or harass because of deep disagreement. You can't control what happens in Israel and Palestine, but you can't control what happens on your campus. So engage with those who have a different point of view. Seek them out, reject dogma, and try to understand why they see things differently. Find or create classes on how to discuss difficult issues creatively, and not just Israel-Palestine, but abortion, immigration, other hot-button issues. Never forget the humanity of your classmates. And, you know, don't call them names. It's like being like Trump, right? If someone on your side does, don't ignore it. Speak out. Say we can disagree, but let's not dehumanize or demonize. And there's nothing more important that you can do than call out transgressions of people on your side of a political debate. So, you know, at the end, seek out and engage people with whom you disagree. In my experience, you'll learn more from the people you disagree with than the people who see the world your way. And you might even change some minds, and you might even sharpen your own. Anyway, let me stop there and take questions. Thank you. Thank you.
We have a microphone for questions and for disagreements.
Absolutely. Please disagree.
Come on.
My question is about the relations between Arabs and Jews, and I believe it's in the Quran, it talks kind of negatively about the Jews, and there's been a lot of historical conflict, and how much of it do you think is historical, religious, and just anti-Semitic, because the lines might be difficult to see.
Yeah, I mean, there are no simple answers, but I think, you know, all things play in part. Religions, by the way, you can find, I think, in every religion, things that are both, promoting treating the stranger, and, you know, there are things in Islam that talk about, you know, Jews and Christians, the people of the book, and there are also things in all religions that talk about the other and vilify the other and see the danger. And both of those tendencies are there. So, I think in practical matters, a religion is what its adherents define it to be in the moment, because you can choose what you want from the text to support where you end up going. And I think some of the religious aspect has part of it. There are some for whom the idea of any land that was seen ever as being under control of Muslims, it's, you know, sacrilegious for somebody else to have control. And I presume for some people there, that's the case. But I see the majority of the people that I see on the Palestinian side that I've interfaced with You know, it's not from a religious perspective, and these are the, you know, the people that are the academics and some of the politicians. It's really this perhaps irreconcilable conflict between two national aspirations over the same land and over control. And again, I don't know how that can be fully resolved, but, you know, and there are people that also, you know, on the Jewish side who use religion to justify. They said God gave us this land, you know, and so the Palestinians disappear from that as human beings when you believe that this is just a matter of control and they should go someplace else. No, they were there too. So, you know, all those parts. And then, you know, let alone the current Israeli politics and the dysfunction of the Palestinian Authority make this even worse. I mean, that's one of the things that it's really depressing. I remember, you know, when the, you know, 93, when, you know, the handshake on the White House lawn, and there were a lot of people saying, ah, yeah, this is finally going to be resolved. And I'm thinking, you know, if I understand history, making peace is going to be harder than making war. And we're in a much worse situation now than I think we were 30 years ago. So I don't know. Maybe one of you guys will have a solution. I certainly don't. But I just see it as all the, you know, people tap into so many different ways of trying to vilify the other. But the background of this is that there's, you know, a contest between two people over the same land and valuing their own identity and self-control.
So, I mean, you kind of talk about how it's dangerous to allow, like, governments and educational institutions to have fixed definitions of anti-Semitism and to, like, regulate, I guess, action based on them. And I guess that kind of made me wonder about, like, what about, like, you know, and but we still have to, like, privately disapprove of anti-Semitism. So, like, what about, like, institutions that are kind of public and kind of private, like social media, in which, like, is it, I guess, when a lot of conversation occurs online, should social media institutions try to define and disrupt anti-Semitism? And if they should, how do their responsibilities differ from that of a government or an educational institution?
It's a great question, because a lot of what people encounter is what happens on, you know, online and social media. I mean, at least under the current regulations as I understand them, I mean, these are private companies. They get to define what's okay and what isn't on their, you know, platforms. It was interesting. There was a conference I went to in Paris. I think it was 2004, 2005. It's really interesting about putting, and this is the time of the attacks on Jews, and it was the French Jewish community that was organizing it. And they said the reason that we have these problems, because of American websites, before Facebook and stuff, but when things were, you know, just on websites and people were worried about that promoting hatred. They said, you know, you guys, First Amendment, just change it, get rid of all this stuff. That's the reason for all our problems. And I remember saying to, you know, them, wait a minute, it's not like you don't have imams in some places preaching and satellite television visions of Israeli soldiers lording over, you know, Arabs and so forth that are part of this puzzle too, though they wanted to have an easy answer. But there were some people there, even though the Europeans have a different tradition on First Amendment, some friends of mine from Copenhagen who had a, you know, an understanding that let's just focus on what works and what people can agree with. So that was sort of the beginning of saying, let's push instead of removing all this stuff, to really just have terms of service. At the best that would do is divide, you know, the internet at that point between what's, you know, totally allowed and what has some restrictions. And the companies have the ability to destroy, to do their own terms of service. And, you know, it's hard. I mean, the Jewish community was pushing Facebook and other groups to adopt the definition. And, you know, I consulted with them and I said, don't. I said, you know, there's legitimate, you know, pro-Palestinian speech that's being targeted by here. But, you know, their policies were basically to talk about you can't vilify, you know, individuals. It can be, you know, threats of violence, group things. But it was mostly to give notice to what's okay and what isn't, and then policing. And some of what's being policed, especially after Christchurch, was, you know, had a counter effect. I had a colleague who documents a lot of things about terrorism and far right groups and jihadi groups and stuff. And his website, you know, basically disappeared, or what he had on, I think, a Facebook group disappeared because this was seen as violative, because he was giving evidence of what these groups were saying, not to promote it, but to educate about it. So there are complexities, you know, here as well. And I was, you know, talking today too, in one of the meetings, that one of the things that I'm focusing on at the center is, you know, I don't know what's ultimately going to be decided by Congress, whether they're going to see more restrictions. I know, at least from the people that I've talked to, they, you know, they do their best. Could they do more? Probably. But I'd rather focus on the flip side of the question, is how do we use social media more effectively against hate? And I think there's a lot more that could be done. I think, you know, for reporting of hate crimes, for discussing and understanding what hatred is, I think we're just beginning that. We tend to focus on the simple solutions, let's wipe it out, rather than saying, okay, the tool's going to be here. What aren't we doing that we can? How do we build coalitions to use it more effectively?
Thank you so much for your talk. I really appreciate your insistence on this opposition to binary thinking. And I think it's really important for us on this campus and for, you know, all of the reasons that you raise. I also think you're right that it's often used as sort of like a mental heuristic to address inequality, right? Mm-hmm. That these people have more, these people have less. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on how to stop binary thinking without erasing inequality. So for example, a common argument is that, you know, things in Israel are quite complex with Israel-Palestine. But the truth is that, you know, Israel as a state has millions upon billions of dollars more than whatever Palestinian resistance there may be. And that funds very different types of weapons and very different types of violence, right? And so we can erase the binary thinking, but we can't erase the inequality of what that looks like for those people. And so I'm wondering kind of what your thoughts are on how to get rid of this mental heuristic that people use to do that without, you know, straying from the facts or, you know, making it a tit for tat and equal back and forth kind of thing.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think that it's critically important to seek out as much information about any issue. And I, you know, I fully agree with you that the complexity of the conflict requires looking at the fact that it, you know, Israel is in a much stronger position than, you know, the Palestinians. And I think, you know, I fear that at some point, decades from now, when, you know, the history of this period gets written, however, it turns out one of the major conclusions may be that the Israelis having that power did not do what it needed to do to help the Palestinians establish their own state, that is actually many things that were being done to try to prohibit it, and that, in my view, backfired. So, you know, those things I think are really important, you know, to consider in the discussion. But what I see some on both sides, again, is sort of the binary as opposed to looking at things that are in context. I'll give you two examples. There's a map that a lot of pro-Israel groups use that shows, and it's true, tiny little Israel in a sea of Arab and Muslim countries. And the point is, look how vulnerable Israel is. And there's a map on the pro-Palestinian side that shows Palestinian lands, you know, from the 1800s to the Declaration of the State to the 67 War to today. And both of those things are true. And you have to look at them, you know, simultaneously. Another example, and it's a couplet I, you know, when I do book readings, is one thing I always point to. There's PACB, which is the Palestinian you know, Campaign for the Academic and Cultural Boycott of Israel, wrote a letter to the Iroquois Confederacy, a group that I know from my work with Dennis Banks, or, you know, a group of, in upstate New York, American Indian folks. And these guys, I was amazed when I, you know, knew them in the 80s. I mean, lacrosse is a passion. They're crazy about lacrosse. It was their game, right? So the PACB folks write to the Iroquois and saying, there's an international lacrosse tournament. You're signed up for it. Don't come. You're indigenous folks like us. It'll be a betrayal. We suffer from settler colonialism. You suffer from settler colonialism. Please be on our side. Don't show up. Okay? I follow that with something from Daniel Pearl, who was is a professor at UCLA. His son, Daniel Pearl, was a reporter who was beheaded a number of years ago. And he said, for those who say Israel is a settler colonial state, name me another country where the people that come in, you know, that are there have 2,000 years of connection in poetry and prose and religion. Name me another place where people come who are settler colonialists and don't name places like New Berlin or New Baghdad and so forth with names that were in biblical times. Name me another place that people speak the language that was spoken there 2,000 years ago. So no way this is settler colonialism. Then I quote a scholar, Seth Nsika, who basically says, real history is the ability to incorporate both of those same things simultaneously. Everything else is communal advocacy. And I think that's right.
Thank you so much. I think that I'm thinking about how in considering historical and contemporary anti-Semitism, it's obviously very valuable to recognize historical patterns that have occurred, certain tropes and narratives that have persisted throughout history and taken on different forms. But I also think that I worry that that can sometimes limit us because it doesn't allow us to fully consider the uniqueness of a certain context. Like, for example, right now, unprecedented context, I think like the existence of the State of Israel in its modern form makes this a completely different time than many other times where anti-Semitism has existed. And I guess I just think that sometimes it's hard to toe that line where it's important to recognize historic patterns without making us quick to assume that things are exactly the same as they've always been and not fully appreciate the uniqueness of a context. And so I just wonder if you have thoughts about towing that line and how to incorporate history without blinding ourselves to changes.
Yeah. Again, anti-Semitism at its core hasn't changed, but its expressions have changed. So, you know, I've mentioned Holocaust denial before. That's a relatively new form. And, you know, the tropes around Zionism are ones that sometimes reflect, again, the core of the idea of Jewish conspiracy. And, you know, even it can set up things unintentionally. I mean, there's a woman named Hadassah Benito, who's a judge in Israel, who was at the UN at the time, 1975, when the UN passed a resolution equating Zionism with racism. And there's a lot of background to that when it was passed, and then 1991 when it was repealed. It was mostly reflective of Cold War politics. But the, you know, she said at the time, historically there have been lies told about Jews, and she saw this as part of that pattern, and part of that was in terms of the how it was being used, and it was being used to basically say, and there were some, you know, instances in the UK, for example, where there was a simple equation. If you're Jewish, you're Zionist. If you're Zionist, you're racist. We don't allow racist groups on campus. We're told in some places you couldn't have a Jewish student group. That's, you know, using that, the contemporary thing, to be absolutely discriminatory about Jews. But again, whereas some of this fits into the classical tropes, world would be better off without Jews, you know, Israel should be wiped off the map, the same types of things, there is a political debate here that has to be taken into context, right? So the, you know, again, think, do the thought experiment. If you're, if you grew up from a family that grew up in Haifa and that fled or was pushed out, or Jaffa or someplace else, what would your view about Israel be? And would your view be that the, you know, we should have one democratic state with votes? And then you realize, well, you know, the, what is the implication of that for Jews, right? And you can make the argument that it's functionally anti-Semitic because Jews are never going to give up their right to control their own future without a fight, and it's preordaining. It's also anti-Palestinian in the sense of how much bloodshed will be there. I mean, I could be wrong about this, but I think that, you know, the two-state solution of all the bad solutions is the only one that has any chance because you're never going to have people giving up the capacity. But it is a political debate, and I think it's important to separate out the fact that, you know, to give space for people to have those views and to call out when they go to things about, you know, anti-Semitic tropes to justify it. But again, if you were, you know, as friends of mine are, who say, you know, this has been a tragedy for our family, and then we can tell you the stories. And to make it even more complicated, you know, one thing I didn't realize is that there have been discussions about the right of return and whether, because sometimes Jewish organizations consider that anti-Semitic because it would flood Israel and Israel would, you know, with the Jews would become a majority if it was fully implemented. And, you know, so there's this discussion about it. And, you know, talking to some Palestinians, I had some Palestinian friends brief a liberal Zionist group that, and I realized, you know, thinking back about Camp David and the difficulties, you know, in with Carter and so forth, and the difficulties of making peace. From the Palestinian perspective, it's not a collective right that we think about it for giving up, making a trade, although ultimately that's what's going to have to happen, right? There's going to have to be some acknowledgement to the right and then some accommodation to make a peace. For individual Palestinians, this is my key. This is my individual right. And that makes it even tougher. I could now have an understanding of why, you know, Arafat was reluctant to go into some of the, you know, Taba and the other deals because there's a perception. And I don't know how to bridge all that, but all those things are part of the puzzle of what people say about Israel. And to even make it more complicated, you know, there are things about when I talk to, you know, to Palestinian friends, just like Jews sometimes in Israel refer to Arabs, they refer to Israelis as Jews. That's just the shorthand that some of them will use. And we see it when they say something about the Jews that's anti-Semitic. And the people I know are very careful about talking about Israelis and stuff. But they grew up, they say, you know, these are the Jews coming into our town. They're the ones with the guns. So it makes it very complicated. And anybody who doesn't have a time to ask a question and wants to come up later, I'm happy to talk to you.
Thank you. You mentioned a lot of the conflicts between Zionists and anti-Zionists and the right of the Israeli people to the state. There's been a lot of protests going on in Israel lately within the state of Israel of people opposing the current government and state representative, the prime minister. And so I wonder if those political conflicts within the Israeli people and in the Israeli state has some kind of continuity to do with the conflicts and the political contestations that we've been talking about today.
Yeah, I think it's a great question. You know, I think the two things, the current debate there is, as you know, is about judicial overhaul and the attempt, I think, on Netanyahu's part to do what Orban did in Hungary and what happened in Poland, basically to just eviscerate the power of judicial oversight so that a majority can impose its will. And Israel doesn't have a written constitution like we do. It has a basic law, but the court has always been the sort of check and balance on the government there. And what's happening is there's the internal Jewish debate in Israel, different than the one I was describing here, is between the growing community of the ultra-Orthodox there, who don't serve in the army and get stipends for studying. And a lot of the secular, you know, part of the Jewish community thinks that's unfair, understandably. And the more religious folks see the judicial reform as necessary for preserving the place that they see in society. So that's a large part of the default. And what's interesting is there have been, I think, Jamil's last name, I forget, from the ACLU just wrote a piece, and there are some others, Palestinians, that are saying, you know, it's interesting that Jews in Israel are talking about democracy and its future democracy and what's going to happen, and going hundreds of thousands of people on the street to protect it. Yeah, with, you know, some exceptions of some of what the court's done for us from time to time. By and large, the court has not been a court of democracy for Palestinians who don't, have the same, opportunities in Israel and certainly in the occupied territories. They're saying all well and good, but we've been saying this for a long time that, the judicial system isn't working for us, and now the ultra-Orthodox is trying to change it because it doesn't work for them. It's clearly going to make it the ability of any Palestinian claim for the court system much harder if this passes, to change how the judiciary is selected, and even more so, just by a majority to overrule. It means the court really has nothing but an advisory opinion. It's not because of the Israel-Palestine divide, but it has an implication for sure if it goes through.
Please join me in thanking Ken for his special.
Thank you.